Psalm 96, verse 9, says that we ought to worship the Lord in holy attire, tremble before him, all the earth. Father, we desire to worship you here this morning. We have gathered together. We are your people, and you are our God. We want to lift up the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and our Savior. Father, we want to glorify you in all that we do. We are well aware, Father, that as we come to worship you today, our worship will be imperfect because it flows out of imperfect hearts. And yet, Father, we know that your Spirit's ministry is to take that which is imperfect and to use it in such a way to bring glory to your name. We pray that he will do that this day. We pray, Father, that you would meet the needs of your people this day. And Father, we pray that you would meet the needs of those who are not yet your people. May your gospel go forth. May the truth of your word, Father, stimulate your people to love and good works. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Standing for the reading of God's word. John.
This morning's reading is 1 Chronicles chapter 15, verses 1 through 15. That's 1 Chronicles chapter 15, verses 1 through 15, the reading of the holy, inspired, inerrant word of God. David built houses for himself in the city of David, and he prepared a place for the ark of God and pitched a tent for it. Then David said, "No one may carry the ark of God but the Levites, for the Lord has chosen them to carry the ark of God and to minister before him forever." And David gathered all Israel together at Jerusalem to bring up the ark of the Lord to its place, which he had prepared for it. Then David assembled the children of Aaron and the Levites, of the sons of Kohath, Uriel, the chief, and 120 of his brethren. Of the sons of Merari, Asaiah, the chief, and 220 of his brethren. Of the sons of Gershom, Joel, the chief, and 130 of his brethren. Of the sons of Elizaphan, Shemaiah, the chief, and 200 of his brethren. Of the sons of Hebron, Eliel, the chief, and 80 of his brethren. Of the sons of Uzziel, Aminadab, the chief, and 112 of his brethren. And David called for Zadok and Abiathar, the priests, and for the Levites, for Uriel, Asaiah, Joel, Shemaiah, Eliel, and Aminadab. And he said unto them, you are the heads of the fathers' houses of the Levites. Sanctify yourselves, you and your brethren, that you may bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel to the place I have prepared for it. For because you did not do it the first time, the Lord our God broke out against us, because we did not consult him about the proper order. So the priests and the Levites sanctified themselves to bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel. And the children of the Levites bore the ark of God on their shoulders by its poles, as Moses had commanded, according to the word of the Lord. You may be seated. We read in here in 1 Chronicles 15 the preparation for a very glorious time in Israel's history as they bring in the Ark of the Covenant into the holy city of Jerusalem. Just by means of review, the Ark of the Covenant was a golden box, and its construction, I think, was laid out in Numbers, if not the book of Leviticus. But within the Ark of the Covenant, it contained the book of the law, the original tablets of stone where Moses took the Ten Commandments, manna from the wilderness, Aaron's rod, and it was, most importantly, had a mercy seat and two cherubim above which the very presence of God rested. So the Ark of the Covenant was a very important part of Israel's history, and it went with them through the wilderness as they now are getting up to this part in their history where they're bringing the Ark into the holy city of Jerusalem. Now, in this passage, we see in verse 14 and 15 a reference to proper order and that the Lord broke out against Israel. And you may recall a couple chapters ago, Brother Mike brought us through the time when David went into the city of Kiriath-Jearim and they wrested the ark away from the Philistines who had taken it from Saul. And in his exuberance and his zeal, they took the ark and they started bringing it towards to Jerusalem with haste. And as they were doing so, I think it was Uzziah put his hand up against the ark and was struck down dead on that moment. And at first, David was a little upset about it, but as he pondered, he realized the Lord had acted according to his word. Here we have now David on reflection as he's getting ready to bring the ark into Jerusalem to do it according to the word of the Lord. And we see the careful measures he takes to ensure that the ark comes into Jerusalem according to the word. He prepares the ark, a place for it within the city. We read that he gathers all of Israel and all the Levites. The Levites are assembled by lineage. So it's a careful reference here to validate that the people that are going to be bringing the ark are truly and indeed Levites, and it can be verified by their family lineage. We see that the ark was borne on the shoulders of the Levites, as it was supposed to be done. There were poles that were constructed for that very purpose to carry the ark. And if you recall, by contrast, in 1 Chronicles 13, the ark was put on a cart. So we see that David is very careful now in how he brings the ark into the city of Jerusalem, and he's making sure that it's done according to the word of the Lord. So what do we learn from this? We read that order in worship is important to God. How we come to worship him isn't something that needs to be taken lightly, but rather it has to be done according to his word. Now David's motives in getting the ark in 1 Chronicles 13 were really good. He was excited. They had wrested the ark from the enemies of Israel, from the Philistines. He was zealous for God. And as he grabs that ark and he hastily brings it back to Jerusalem, he didn't consult God nor follow the word of God. And the end thereof, of that journey of the ark, was not blessed. So likewise, as we see what's happening here in 1 Chronicles 15, we realize that our God is a God of order, and he lays out his steps of worship very carefully, and he expects obedience from us as his people. So in terms of applications, I think it teaches us that when we approach God, we need to do so according to his word. A practical example, we see the Lord's table before us this morning. And many of us have a good motive to come to the Lord's table. We want a fellowship. We want to break bread with our brothers and sisters. We want to look forward to the coming of Christ, and we want to look back on his death and resurrection. However, God puts forth very careful rules on how we are to partake of his table, and pastors very careful each Lord's Day Sunday to make sure that we understand those rules of worship. Because even though our motives may be pure, we are to partake of the bread and of the cup according to the word of the Lord. So that's one principle. Another one I'd like to bring out is that we read here that the priests sanctified themselves prior to carrying the ark. And I think that it's an important reminder for all of us as we seek to serve God. While we've been sanctified eternally by the blood of Christ and we don't carry any of our own sin, if we seek to worship and serve God, we need to do with an eye on our own personal holiness. Because to serve God acceptably means that we serve him in a sanctified manner. And we don't want to approach God in worship and in service with a cavalier type of an attitude without an eye on our own behavior. I mean, think about the Levites were called out from amongst the children of Israel. All eyes were on them as they carried this ark that carried the very presence of God. And they were meant to be holy. And likewise, as we serve God, you know, the eyes of the world are on us. The eyes of our brothers and sisters are on us. And we need to ensure that our conduct and our personal holiness is worthy of the Savior in which we serve. Because everyone likes to say how the church is full of hypocrites. All right, so let's make sure that we're not one of the people that the world points at and says, huh, he goes to church, look at him or her. Right? And while we all fall into sin, we need to make sure that our conduct is becoming of following our Lord and our Savior. And I'll close on this one. You know, I see a dark snapshot here. We see the saints being called out from amongst the people. We see them sanctified and holy, and we see the very presence of God on their shoulders as they move towards Jerusalem. And as I think on that, I think of our own journey here in our world. And we are sanctified by the blood of Christ, and the presence of God is amongst us. And we head towards that holy Jerusalem that will be revealed on the last day. And we'll see that expressed more in next week's reading. But brothers and sisters, we have a destination in our journey. And that destination is the heavenly and holy Jerusalem, where God and his glory will be fully revealed with all of his saints. Amen.
Exhortations that are always timely for God's people. Father, we've gathered together here to give you worship, and so we appreciate these reminders of what worship ought to be like. And even as our brother has exhorted us, Father, we realize that our worship in many ways falls short. We seek to be controlled in our congregational worship by the precepts of your word. But Father, even in our own personal lives, we realize that there are times when we come together here when we have other things on our mind. We have not consecrated ourselves to worship. We have not prepared ourselves before we walk in these doors. We come, Father, and we're distracted, and perhaps our minds are elsewhere. We want to be somewhere else. But Father, we pray you would forgive us for these things, that your Spirit would work among your people to make us a worshipful people, a people who desires to see your face, a people who desire to understand and know your word, a people who desire to give our offerings unto you and our praise to you, to see you magnified in the name of Jesus Christ lifted up. Make us a people like that, Father. We thank you that you forgive. You do not strike us down when we come before you in an unworthy manner, for our sin is under the blood of Christ, and we are grateful for that. But we are not who we will be. One day, as our brother has reminded us, we will stand before you, people from every tongue and tribe and nation, and we will offer you worship and praise that will be pure, completely in spirit and truth. Father, we await that day. But now, Father, we thank you for your mercy. Your word reminds us of your great mercy. Now thus says the Lord, your creator, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Thank you, Father, for this great grace that is ours. In Christ's name, amen. Turn with me, if you would, to Psalm 41. We continue to read through the Psalms this morning. Psalm 41. How blessed is he who considers the helpless. The Lord will deliver him in a day of trouble. The Lord will protect him and keep him alive, and he shall be called blessed upon the earth. And do not give him over to the desire of his enemies. The Lord will sustain him upon his sickbed. In his illness, you restore him to health. As for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me. Heal my soul, for I have sinned against you. My enemies speak evil against me. When will he die and his name perish? And when he comes to see me, he speaks falsehood. His heart gathers wickedness to itself. When he goes outside, he tells it. All who hate me whisper together against me. Against me they devise my hurt, saying a wicked thing is poured out upon him. Then when he lies down, he will not rise up again. Even my close friend in whom I trusted, who ate my bread, has lifted up his heel against me. But you, O Lord, be gracious to me and raise me up that I may repay them. By this I know that you are pleased with me, because my enemy does not shout in triumph over me. As for me, you uphold me in my integrity, and you set me in your presence forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. Father, we're grateful for your word. It is such an encouragement to us. We realize, Father, that there are those in our congregation this morning who are on their sick beds. We realize, Father, that there are those within our fellowship whom others have sinned against, and there are enemies speaking evil against them. And yet you, Father, are the one who vindicates your people, and you are the one who heals your people. According to your purposes and your will, you do these things. And so it is our prayer this morning, Father, that you would look down upon your people and your spirit would move among us in such a way that we might understand that you are a sovereign God. In all of the difficulties of this life, you are in control. Though we understand or we don't understand, Father, we trust in you, not in what we see, but in what we know according to your word. We are grateful to you, Father, because you are gracious to us. And you raise us up. We thank you, Father, that you are pleased with us because we stand before you in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And there will come a day when we stand before you with the world in judgment, and you will separate the sheep from the goats, and it will be made known that we belong to you. We will in that day be vindicated, and we will be set in your presence forever. We thank you for these things, Father. And we know that you are still building your kingdom even now, and that the gospel goes forth and your spirit uses it to bring to life those who are dead in spirit. You are doing that today, Father, in pulpits around the world. You are doing that today through your people, through missionaries who have gone out to other nations to bring the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for this great grace, and we thank you for the ability to meet together here in this place to sing praises unto you and to hear from you and to be encouraged by you and to be challenged by you and convicted by your word. Father, use this day to make us the kinds of people that you desire us to be, people who are different than we were when you found us. May we even leave this place this day different than we were when we walked in. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen.
Will the ushers please come forward? This morning we have two offerings. And now behold the first fruits of the land, which thou, O Lord, hast given me. And thou shalt set it before the Lord thy God, and worship before the Lord thy God. Thank you, Lord, for all you have given us. Lord, we depend on you, and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to look this morning at Proverbs chapter 1, verses 1 through 7, which is kind of the introduction to the entire book. The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel. To know wisdom and instruction, to discern the sayings of understanding, to receive instruction in wise behavior, righteousness, justice, and equity, to give prudence to the naive, to the youth, knowledge, and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning, and a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. To understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Father, as we embark upon this journey through the book of Proverbs, we ask, Father, that you would be the one who leads us, that your Spirit would be the one who teaches us. We ask, Father, that you would help us to know ourselves through this study, and that through this study we might know wisdom. Lead us in this, Father. We are a needy people. We are a foolish people in so many ways. We need to be instructed. We need understanding. Give it, Father, by your word, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Believe it or not, some people still buy books made of paper. And they do so. Some people actually still buy them, not online, but in these things they call bookstores. There aren't many of them around anymore. But if you were to enter one of these, and then make your way over to the magazine section and browse through it, you might well become convinced that the good life has to do with the right food, and the right cigar, and the right watch. There are magazines devoted to taking the right vacation, going to the right college, wearing the right clothes, having the right wedding. These things, we're told, are the things that will bring happiness. These are what the good life consists of. U.S. News and World Report will tell you that the seven secrets to a successful retirement. I'm assuming secret number one is have a lot of money. Right? If you move from the magazine section to the book section, one might think things would improve. One would be wrong, of course. Let me just read you a few titles of currently best-selling books that you can find in that bastion of intellectualism, the self-help section. Choose Yourself, Be Happy, Make Millions, Live the Dream. Four Agreements, The Practical Guide to Personal Freedom. You want to know what they are? First agreement, be impeccable with your word. The second agreement, don't take anything personally. The third agreement, don't make assumptions. The fourth agreement, always do your best. There, I just saved you $15. $15 for what used to be called common sense. Finding the on-ramp to your spiritual path. The author of this book, we're told, was reared as a Catholic and has traveled through Buddhist and Hindu and Muslim cultures, merging dualities of East and West. Issues of truth apparently need not be considered. And we could literally go on and on and on, but I have to share with you my personal favorite. It's by someone you may be familiar with. Perhaps you've seen him as you race past PBS with your remote. His name is Wayne Dyer, and he's got a lot of books out. This one is called 10 Secrets for Success and Inner Peace. I'll just give you the first one for the sake of time. Have a mind that is open to everything and attached to nothing. Now, if you were to walk into a Christian bookstore, if you can still find a Christian bookstore, you would find something quite different. Unfortunately, the difference is that the self-help section is called Christian Living. Other than that, there's not a whole lot of difference there. It's very similar to what you'll find in a secular bookstore. Let me give you some titles from the Christian bestseller lists. Changes That Heal: How to Understand Your Past and Ensure a Healthier Future. I guess poor old Paul was wrong when he said, "One thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." This author thinks you have to go back and stay in your past. Paul says, no, forget it, go forward. 1,000 Gifts, A Dare to Live Fully Right Where You Are. I Declare, 31 Promises to Speak Over Your Life. The Ultimate Guide to the Daniel Fast. Have you seen this? The Daniel Fast, 100 recipes plus 21 daily devotionals. The only difference between the secular and the so-called Christian, it seems, is there's some religious language thrown in to the Christian books. Now, what all of this should tell us is that there is within the human heart a knowledge that there is something that we might call the good life, and that we don't have it. And we really don't know what it is. And we don't know how to find it. And we are brought once again back to this foundational truth that we saw throughout our study in Isaiah. The world is not what it ought to be. There is something wrong. There is something missing. And this knowledge, this understanding, is the first step to seeing the book of Proverbs as we ought. It is the first step to seeing Christ here. As Christians, we come to Proverbs presupposing its inspiration. It is a part of the canon of Scripture. It is the God-breathed, inspired Word of God. But in addition to that, we also must presuppose that, like the rest of the Bible, Proverbs has Christ at its center. As Jesus was walking along the road to Emmaus with two of his disciples after the resurrection, we're told in Luke that he opened all of the scriptures to them, the law and the prophets, the entire Old Testament, and taught them how he was everywhere in the Old Testament. Christ is here in Proverbs as well, though his name may not be found. One of the ways that we see Christ here is in recognizing that in the long history of the human race, only Jesus has perfectly and completely exemplified the wisdom that is spoken in this book. Another way in which we see Jesus here in Proverbs is by recognizing that it is only through the power of the indwelling Spirit of Christ that we can even begin to apply the wisdom of this book to our own lives. When we come to Proverbs, as to any other portion of Scripture, though he's not mentioned by name, we must recognize Christ is here. Even as Proverbs portrays the wise man, we understand that wise man is Jesus. He is the man of wisdom and of understanding and discernment. And it is only when we see Christ here and see this book through that lens that we will understand Proverbs as God intended us to understand it. In the coming months, it's my intention that we look together at this book through the lens of Christ then. We're going to look at subjects like wisdom and the heart and what it means to be righteous. We'll look at what Proverbs has to say about the home and the poor and the fool and the wicked and adultery and wealth and our tongues. And I want us to see all of this in reference to Christ. If we do not see Christ here, We are not seeing the scripture as God intends us. If someone were to come to the book of Proverbs and preach Proverbs without mentioning the name of Christ, he may have given you a nice lecture on ethics, but he has not preached a Christian sermon. So let us begin our journey this morning at the very beginning. In this introductory paragraph in chapter 1, verses 1 through 7, these verses act as the introduction to the entire book. Let's start with verse 1, the Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel. The Proverbs, what exactly is a proverb? The book of Proverbs defines it for us itself in chapter 25, verse 11, when it speaks of words aptly spoken, like apples of gold in settings of silver. These are pearls of wisdom. Right? Proverbs is part of the wisdom literature of ancient Israel. They consist of instruction for right living. They are words of wisdom, which, if one will take heed to them and listen to their instruction, will lead to the good life, not as our culture defines it, but as God defines it. These are, we're told, the Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel. So these are the words of a king. They are words written in large part by the king of Israel named Solomon. Not all of them. Solomon collected many of these. Some are under different authorship, and we'll see that as we work through. There are sections of Proverbs that come from others, but the majority belong to Solomon, either as the author or the collector. And in Solomon, we find a man who ruled over Israel, one of the greatest kings who ever lived, perhaps the greatest. He grew up in the presence of another king, his father, David. And so he enjoyed all of the advantages of that position, being instructed by David, looking at David's example, receiving the prayers and the blessings of his father. In 1 Kings chapter 10, we read this description of his reign. So King Solomon became greater than all the kings of the earth in riches and in wisdom. All the earth was seeking the presence of Solomon to hear his wisdom, which God had put in his heart. They brought every man his gift, articles of silver and gold, garments, weapons, spices, horses, and mules, so much year by year. Now Solomon gathered chariots and horsemen, and he had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horsemen. And he stationed them in the chariot cities and with the king in Jerusalem. The king made silver as common as stones in Jerusalem. And he made cedars as plentiful as sycamore trees that are in the lowland. Also Solomon's import of horses was from Egypt and Kew, and the king's merchants procured them from Kew for a price. A chariot was imported from Egypt for 600 shekels of silver and a horse for 150. And by the same means, they exported them to all the kings of the Hittites and to the kings of the Arameans. Few kings write books, but surely someone who has ruled over a nation as Solomon did probably has some things to teach us. But these are not only the words of a king, they're also the words of a wise man. The scriptures speak of many wise men in Israel. David's court had a place for wise counselors, we're told in 1 Chronicles 27. We also read of the wise woman of Tekoa and another from Abel, which was a town with a reputation for wisdom, according to 2 Samuel 14. 1 Kings chapter 4 refers to other wise men of Solomon's own day. But it seems that none of them were as wise as Solomon himself. 1 Kings 4 tells us that Solomon's wisdom was greater than the wisdom of all the men of the East and greater than the wisdom of Egypt. In 1 Kings 10, we read of a visit paid to Solomon by the Queen of Sheba. Now, when the Queen of Sheba heard about the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with difficult questions. So she came to Jerusalem with a very large retinue, with camels carrying spices and very much gold and precious stones. And when she came to Solomon, she spoke with him about all that was in her heart. And Solomon answered all her questions. Nothing was hidden from the king, which he did not explain to her. When the queen of Sheba perceived all the wisdom of Solomon, the house that he had built, the food at his table, the seating of his servants, the attendance of his waiters and their attire, his cupbearers and his stairway by which he went up to the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her. Then she said to the king, "It is a true report which I heard in my own land about your words and your wisdom. Nevertheless, I did not believe the reports until I came and my eyes had seen it." But of course, the wisdom was not mere human wisdom, because we're not just dealing here with the words of a king or the words of a human wise man. We're dealing with the words of God, as we have said earlier. These are the words of God himself. They come through men, of course, Solomon and others, but they are, in the end, the inspired word of God. Words of men may be helpful. Words of men may be instructive. Words of men may be enlightening, but the words of God are authoritative, and we must pay heed to them. As is true of all Scripture, God had a purpose in providing it to us. Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:16 that all Scripture is inspired and profitable. How are the Proverbs profitable? Well, we need not seek our own on our own to devise an answer to that question. The very first portion of this book, the rest of this passage, speaks about how the book of Proverbs is to profit us. It's God's own answer. There are great purposes in this book, and though they overlap, they are fivefold. And let's just tear this apart as we go through this passage this morning. We find the first purpose in verse 2, the attaining of wisdom and discipline, or wisdom and instruction, same word for discipline. The chief use of this book is to gain wisdom or skill. The word translated wisdom carries with it that idea of skill, but we are not speaking of skill in a trade or in art or in athletics. We're talking about skill in life. How do we live well? It is the skill which enables one to live successfully. Jeremiah prophesied that the Messiah would possess this kind of wisdom. Jeremiah 23, verse 5, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he will reign as king and act wisely and do justice and righteousness in the land." And then once the Messiah had come, Paul tells us that we also might have this wisdom as we come to possess the mind of Christ. You see Christ here. He is the perfectly wise one. If you took all the wisdom of this book and sought for one who would embody all of it, you would find only one, the Lord Jesus Christ. But this wisdom doesn't come to us naturally. We are born without this kind of wisdom. We are not born with the mind of Christ. This wisdom is hard won. It necessitates instruction and discipline. To know wisdom and instruction. This doesn't come to us overnight. This is the second term we find here in verse 2. Wisdom is a matter of character and discipline and discipleship. We often hear of people described as overnight sensations. Right? Then you dig a little further and you find that this didn't happen overnight at all. It was after years of struggle and effort that they become successful. So it is with wisdom. But if one is willing to discipline oneself for the purpose of godliness, then wisdom can be yours. It is that which James says we are to ask God for when we are lacking it. And he will give generously. The second thing we're told is, in regard to the purpose of the book of Proverbs, is that it is to discern the sayings of understanding. It is for the understanding of words that will give us insight. This is another purpose of the book, although you can't really separate these purposes. They're all of a piece. Every now and then, I'll turn on the Antiques Roadshow. I don't know if any of you watch that at all, but I'm amazed at the knowledge of these people. They can pick up a piece of pottery and in a moment be able to tell you whether it has made you rich or whether you shouldn't even bother lugging it home because it's not worth anything. Right? They have developed this ability to discern the valuable from the worthless. They've learned to distinguish between things that differ. And this is a quality that each of us needs to develop. According to Hebrews 5:14, mature Christians have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. I don't care if you ever learn how to distinguish good pottery from bad pottery. I want you to learn how to distinguish good from evil. That's what I want to learn as well. And the book of Proverbs can be a great help to us in that process. Well-coiffed hair, nice clean-shaven face, a bright toothy grin, and an audience of thousands does not guarantee the presence of truth. We need to develop discernment. We need to learn to discern good from evil and right from wrong and truth from falsehood. And Proverbs will help us in that. True wisdom is very practical. And so the third purpose that we find here is to receive instruction in wise behavior, righteousness, justice, and equity. True wisdom is practical. It involves good sense. It encompasses not only discipline, but also careful thought and prudence and insight. Once again, this is something that describes Jesus. In Isaiah chapter 52, verse 13, in regard to the Messiah, we read that my servant, God speaking, of course, my servant will act wisely. We see this kind of disciplined, prudent life in Christ and in those who seek to follow him. We see in Christ actions that are only just, only righteous, only fair. And these are the things that will characterize his followers, those who are seeking to be like him. A man who thinks he is wise but is unjust and immoral needs to think again. He is not just. He is not wise, rather. He is a fool. And have we not seen sufficient example of this in recent Supreme Court cases? Now, you know I'm not a political preacher, but when events so clearly illustrate the truth of Scripture, I'm going to make use of them. We have supposedly 9 of the wisest people that our nation has to offer. They sit as judges in the highest court in the land, and yet time after time, from Roe v. Wade to the last abominable rulings regarding Proposition 8 and the Defense of Marriage Act, they demonstrate that the majority are devoid of wisdom. Wisdom is absent, but there is an overabundance of foolishness. Anthony Kennedy, the author of the majority opinion in the DOMA case, apparently believes himself to possess the capability of reading hearts and minds. In that opinion, written for the majority, he makes no legal or constitutional arguments. Rather, he says that supporters of the Defense of Marriage Act were motivated by an improper animus against a politically unpopular group they wish to disparage, demean, and humiliate as unworthy. And so he apparently feels himself able to read the motivations of other people. He believes himself to be discerning, and yet he is devoid of discernment. Paul Johnson's book, The Intellectuals, is a disturbing expose of how men such as Hemingway and Ibsen and Marx and Bertrand Russell, despite their intellectual brilliance, proved to be moral disasters in their private lives. All the way through this book of Proverbs, we see the interconnection between true wisdom and true righteousness. They are inseparable. Immorality is not characteristic of wisdom, but of foolishness. And Proverbs will help us to learn the difference. The fourth purpose of Proverbs is given in verses 4 and 5, to give prudence to the naive, to the youth, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning, and a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. This speaks of those who are immature, those who are untaught. Literally, it speaks of those who are open, ready to receive anything that comes to them, good or bad. Perhaps you've heard the expression that a person is so open-minded that their brains fell out. That's what we're talking about here. This is a characteristic of the young, though not exclusively so. Today we hear a great deal about the virtues of open-mindedness, and there is something to that. We ought not to be afraid of ideas simply because they are unfamiliar or we haven't come to confront them yet. But what is not a virtue is the kind of open-mindedness that never settles itself on truth. What is not a virtue is the kind of open-mindedness that is forever searching and never finding. That kind of a person, the scripture says, is one tossed about by every wind. That kind of person is foolish and ignorant and aimless. And that is not name-calling. The scripture uses those terms to describe those who take pride in always searching but never coming to a conclusion. It speaks of those who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. It speaks of the skeptic and the agnostic. It speaks of the one who can never rule anything out because he has put no boundaries of truth around his life and around his thought. But there is a solution. There is truth, and there is wisdom. And young people, this book is so important for you. You have so much to learn. And you don't even know how much you have to learn. You too, you are to varying degrees simple, what the New American Standard calls naive, and foolish, and immature. In other words, you're young. That's not a criticism, it's simply a fact. The tragedy is when people grow old and remain naive, and remain foolish, and remain immature. Young people, Proverbs is a great gift to you. It will make you wise. It will give you understanding. It will teach you how to live in this fallen world and how to please God. It is said that we learn by experience. But it's also been said that it's much better to learn by other people's experience. In Proverbs, you can learn from the wisest man who ever lived and thereby avoid the same mistakes that he and so many others have made. But this book is not only for the young. Verse 5 says this is also for the wise, that they might add to their learning, and for the discerning, that they might receive guidance. You see, no matter where you are in your walk with Christ, Proverbs is for you. Proverbs will benefit you. You will find profit here in this book. Proverbs will help you grow. God will use it in your sanctification. There is no one who has ever gotten to a point in their growth when they do not need this book. Every one of us needs this. Every one of us needs to come to the book of Proverbs with a teachable spirit and with the desire for the Spirit of God to work within us and convict us of those areas where we are not meeting God's standards, when we are being foolish. And certainly it's possible to become wise and then to fall back into foolishness. And so our lives need to be evaluated all the time in the light of the wisdom of God. Well, finally, the fifth purpose of this book we find in verse 6. It is to understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. This book is here to get you thinking and to teach you how to think properly. Most of our thinking is really quite shallow. So many people want to avoid the big questions rather than to struggle with them. There are a few who purposely want to think and to talk and to struggle with questions about God and death and the soul and the meaning of life. True wisdom is not like that. True wisdom tackles those kinds of questions. True wisdom goes to the heart of the matter. This book will help us to be able to think. So when we hear the world spout off arguments about why abortion is a good thing, we will be able to cut through the trash and to get to the heart of the matter and to know the truth in regard to these issues that we face. day after day, and week after week, and year after year. True wisdom goes to the heart of the matter. And what is the heart of the matter? It's found in verse 7. It's lesson number one in attaining wisdom. It governs everything else that we will learn throughout our study of this book. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Here is the beginning, the first and controlling principle. To the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the wise show fear because he is our creator. We fear him because he is holy and because we are steeped in sin. What is this fear of which Solomon speaks? It is not a simple concept. It contains many shades of meaning, all appropriate to our relationship with this God. There is a servile kind of fear that a slave has to a master. And there is a sense in which this is a legitimate kind of fear in our relationship to God. Certainly we ought to fear God in this way. He is the God of all power. He is the Lord over each and every one of us. He is not our buddy in the sky. He is the God of the universe who created us and will one day hold us accountable. We ought to fear this God. It is also certainly right for those in certain conditions to fear God and his power to throw them into hell. This is a very basic fear that the demons know very well. If you are not a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you have not received his grace through faith in him to the justification and forgiveness of your sins through repentance and faith, you ought to fear God in this way. Fear the one who can throw body and spirit into hell. There is also a fear and reverence for the majesty and the splendor of God. Certainly, this is the kind of fear that we exhibit as we gather before him today, as we come to worship him. We acknowledge that he is due reverence. When John spoke of the way we ought to worship and that God has defined his worship and he is very particular about his worship, we understand that we must come to him with a reverence that is a kind of fear. Perhaps the highest of all is what we might call filial fear, the fear of a son for a father. The New Testament makes this clear, but the Old Testament anticipates it. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope for his loving kindness. Not hope as in wishing, but those who are looking forward to the fulfillment of his loving kindness in our lives when we stand before him. And his grace is declared to us, and we are ushered into his kingdom. There is a fear there. When we consider that God is our Father and our entire salvation is dependent upon him and him alone. Without the fear of God, there is no wisdom or knowledge, and without these, there is no life. The eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him to deliver them from death and keep them alive. Once again, we're led back to Christ. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 3 tells us about this shoot that will come from the stump of Jesse, who would possess the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of power, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Even Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, had a fear of the Lord. Do you see how all of this comes together? Scripture makes clear that salvation is through Christ alone and that salvation is near to those who fear him. A rich store of salvation and wisdom and knowledge, we're told, is found in Christ alone. And the fear of the Lord is the key to that treasure. And so I've got to ask you this morning, do you fear the Lord? Do you seek to obey and to serve and to worship him? Or are you despising true wisdom and understanding and instruction and discipline? To seek anything else but true godly fear is to go the way of foolishness. It is to reject the true wisdom found only in Christ. Without Christ, this book of Proverbs degenerates into nothing but moralism. And moralism will not save you. Moralism will damn you. You will be an externally good person going to hell. Over these next weeks and months, let us together come to Proverbs in search of wisdom, but let us find that wisdom in Christ. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful this morning for your word. We thank you, Father, for all the truth that is contained in this book that we are going to be unfolding in the future. We pray, Father, that you would give us tender hearts, hearts that desire to not only know you better, but to know ourselves. Give us hearts, Father, hungry for instruction and understanding and discipline. Cause us, Father, not to be naive, but to grow in knowledge and discretion. Cause us to increase in learning and to acquire wise counsel. Do these things for us, Father, that you might be glorified in us, that we might have the mind of Christ, that we might become more and more conformed to your Son. This is what your word is intended to do. This is what the book of Proverbs is intended to do. Father, accomplish this in us. Convict us of sin and let us run to you, Father, for forgiveness and for restoration. We pray, Father, that should there be any here this morning that do not know your Son, Father, may your word reach down by your Spirit to change them, that they might understand that salvation is found only in that perfect wise one, Jesus Christ, who came into this world and went to the cross in the place of sinners, and that only by trusting in him and repenting of our sin can we even take the first step to becoming truly wise. Instill your fear within us, Father, we ask, that we might be wise, that we might be like Christ, that we might not be fools, but that we might be wise unto salvation. For Christ's sake, we ask it. Amen.
Ooh! the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.